Can't we make it all three teams here? See if they can do it. We're in a champ select.
Why not indeed, Freak? Now, you did bring up a point during our interview, that interview, where you talked about LMQ are so good at picking people off.
Yeah.
Is that they're great at picking people off, or is that Cloud9 are great at walking into picks?
Both.
Because one of them, at least one of them, was just walking straight into
That's true.
So
that's true.
We have to see. Vision control, though, regardless, either way is going to be important so they can avoid those picks that LMQ are looking for, trying to kill people. Go more for kills than objectives. LMQ, though, they can easily go straight back to their core game plan. Yeah. Have the early game team fights, win the dragon fights, take objectives off of those, go back to the comfort picks.
So we'll see what the teams find. Soraka and Shyvana still banned away. We'll see if LMQ adds the Ziggs again. The Ziggs have been banned every single game so far. I don't know if they changed that plan. C19 making, I think, a smart adaptation, banning away Nidalee in this matchup.
Yeah.
Not allowing that.
So they've learned.
Well, they also banned Ori, though, because they've added that ban on for a while against Xiao Wei Xiao.
Yeah, I mean, they're leaving Ori up, but I don't feel like that's as big of a deal as the Nidalee.
And Ziggs still removed.
They could still ban it, too. And they've only banned Caitlyn as well. So all the other AD carries will still be available. They're just trying to take that away from Vasili. Now, Lucian. Yeah.
Lucian,
the last
ban,
last ban's either going to be Lucian or Orianna. Now, the real question is, who are they more afraid of?
Maybe not named Kha'Zix? Nope,
which player? No, yeah. Okay, so it is that. They're gonna give the possibility of a first pick Lucian, in which case, they could take a Kha'Zix. They could take a Renekton. I don't know. It's an interesting trade-off here.
Yeah, if this was 4.4, you'd say Lulu. We've seen it a little bit.
I mean, Lulu would probably be the answer pick to whatever other mid laner gets picked first.
Well, keep in mind, this is a game. I think it was game 3, actually, where C9T taxed Bishu's champ pool so hard that he was forced back on the Syndra that didn't work well. Syndra's 0-2 in this series.
Yeah.
LMQ could continue to attack the mid lane pool, grab another thing that Bishu would like to play, like Lulu. And I feel like that's an important pick for these guys.
They give up the Kha'Zix and go... I mean, they give up the Lucian, go for Kha'Zix instead. So,
yep.
Lucian is definitely available, as well as... okay, never mind.
Yep, Lucian's available. The Renekton
worked
last time.
They can lock in quicker than I can speak.
It's true.
But anyways, those are the two that we talked about. However, support's still up. For Morgana, for some reason, has been a really high priority for these guys as well.
Yeah.
It looks like it's kind of dropped off as the games have progressed here. Because it's been, I mean, it's been a good champion, but Thresh has been equally as impactful. Don't feel like it's worth knocking any of these picks lower on the scale. So I think this is a good adaptation for both.
Yeah, and Graves comes through anyway, so Lucian not even, I mean, they grabbed it, but it pushed them onto Graves. Graves was a good performance from Vasili before anyway.
No mid laner yet. The hard counter pick is guaranteed for Cloud9 if they want to leave their mid till last. Likewise, they could jump for that Lulu, who's a safe all-around mid laner to go with if he's worried about getting cornered.
And I'm wondering what else is in that pool for him right here. He's already taken 4 mid lane bans. You've always got to make sure you know what else is available to you in this one. But C19 now going to take their time with this one. Top lane Lee Sin, jungle Kha'Zix, AD carry Graves. A very damage-heavy lineup. I think every top lane Lee Sin gets one or two offensive items before they start. Whether it's Brutalize or Last Whisper, I've seen that. Or the Hydra Rush. Sometimes even seen BT Rush. But I feel like we are going to have damage in a lot of plays for LMQ.
And Ackerman does have the teleport still sitting on that, so likely the teleport Lee Sin.
Mm-hmm.
Looking to shove the lanes very quickly and then move around the map. So they do go early Lulu, get that safe early pick for the mid lane.
Yeah.
There's not like hard counter picks for Lulu, so it's an all-around safe pick there for Bishu. Locking in the jungler, I thought it was going to be an Elise locked in.
Yeah,
Evelynn, sure. Very similar, though. It's right up there as far as Kez's rankings go. So it's actually going to put more threat on the map early without him having to be there.
True.
Just the, as we talked about before, the vision tax that Evelynn brings, as well as the threat that sort of makes the solo lanes play a little bit safer because they always have to respect an Evelynn.
Yeah, and if we actually saw last time there was an Evelynn there, significant pink ward purchase from LMQ, that Evelynn tax, as you described it. There's going to be that little bit of an invisible gold lead going on to see if LMQ can stop the ganks coming through. The last few seconds taken out, and LMQ are going to go support Annie here for more.
So last time he hovered over it, this time they actually pulled the trigger.
Yeah.
They're going so damage heavy here. This team for LMQ is all about quick quick bursting. They're picking people off. They're bursting down single targets. They can actually burst down several targets at once with the Annie and Graves.
Arguably, yeah.
But man, that duo as just a lane, level 6, is terrifying. And
yes.
Annie Graves lane, level 6, is one of the most terrifying things that you can have in the duo lane.
So C9T backing up with some defensive pickups as well.
I
still like Karma vs. Graves, another matchup where you've got a big poke lead. Also, judging by my knowledge of these players, I feel like Moore is likely to start with like a Ruby Crystal. So in two-on-ones, you've actually got a slight push lead here. I feel like it's
because
mid Lulu and support.
Thief start.
Yeah, because sorry, yeah, I didn't finish the thought. Because
I'm right there with you.
No, we're there, but I'm thinking of extra level ahead. I think C9T will still swap these. I don't think it's mid Karma.
Yeah.
It's very unlikely, but I was thinking like Lulu is a flex pick regardless. I like that they picked it up early then waited on their true support pick.
Let's see if they do swap it.
Well, I think the rules... they do.
It's 20 seconds.
Cutoff is 20 seconds. They put it back there. Bishu ignite Lulu actually as well. So wanting to fight his opponents, not the heal stack necessarily. Renekton Eve, still very, very fun. Also ignite Renekton here. So actually a lot of changes.
And the Lulu, talking about changes in the new patch, she cannot actually pull off the double Glitterance even if she stacks up cooldown reduction before you were able to get to it. And I felt like that's where a lot of Lulu kills came from, is people, especially the first time around, not expecting the picks to stay on you that long and getting off a second Glitterance. That's not available anymore. So it's pretty much all about that upfront damage.
Yeah.
And you just have to worry about the speed. That still catches people off guard with Lulu.
Yeah.
Surprise factor, I think, is a really big deal with this champion.
Yeah, and the cool thing is we've actually seen people change their builds around a little bit, kind of as a result of that change, actually.
Yeah.
Yesterday in the semifinal, we saw Xiaowei on Lulu go like one or two Doran's Ring into first item Sheen to just shove in against the Nidalee and just deal damage to that turret. Say, well, there's no point in rushing CDR. It's not going to affect me that much. I'll get some extra AP and mana and get the Sheen damage. And actually took mid turret tier 1 and tier 2 because of that. He had so much pressure on the lane that he got his team a global objective lead. So I kind of want to track the item progression there from Bishu, see how he does with this Lulu here. Again, I like that they picked it up fairly early in the rotation, didn't allow that to get stolen away because that's kind of important to make sure your mid laner gets something comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
So Bishu being back on something he cares about, that he's good with, it's going to be something to watch for.
Yeah, I'm very excited for this game because it feels like LMQ are the ones who make the first decision. They're the ones with the high damage team if they can execute well. If they can execute well, if they can get the vision and get the first step, the initiation on even the little skirmishes, then they can come out ahead. However, C9 being the more beefy team, the more resilient set of champions, if LMQ make a misstep in one of those fights, it's very easy for Cloud9 to punish them for it.
It's going to be about the gold lead then in this one. Cloud9 Tempest chilling by their blue buff right now, but LMQ stacking up pretty early on the top side of the map. We'll see what happens with these teams. It is Ruby Crystal and a ward start for Moore. He's actually already put that one down.
Ooh, early W start from Annie as well. Already got the stun.
Okay. It is a 1.25 second stun. It's been nerfed a couple of patches ago to be shorter early game, but still incredibly important. Still have an area of effect stun at level 1.
Yeah, still enough to kill somebody at a level 1 team fight.
Yeah, when you got Kha'Zix Lee Sin, some good damage there. Right now, C9T, though, waiting around on the wings. Kez actually off on the side, being Evelyn. He can stand outside the brush and be invisible.
All right. Yuzuki has switched off his teleport. Was holding onto that one through champion select, but he's going Ignite Renekton.
Yeah, 2 ignites, 2 heals in the team.
This is one of the few times where LMQ actually have the teleport advantage moving towards late game. See how well Ackerman can use that to his advantage. Lee Sin versus Renekton. Interesting matchup here with Lee Sin being down his combat summoner. It will be, again, influenced by junglers pretty easily.
And it looks like we're going to have a 2-on-1 with the lanes, I would say, in something like an advantage for C9T. Top lane turret, of course, part of the takedown, and with LMQ dedicating their dual lane up there, it's actually going to be harder. I mean, we've seen now 2 games in a row C9T getting an early objective lead because of lane swaps, whether it's 2 turrets for 0, 2 turrets for 1, plus a dragon. C9T starts these games away early, and they won the last game just because of objective control. It's a thing to keep in mind here.
Yeah.
Yatsuki, though, with Ignite, is on the wrong side of the map. He's going to have to run all the way down to join Kez with the buffs and whatnot.
Ackerman, Yuzuki is kind of floundering in there. He's just getting up the ward on red and then trying to get some jungle experience. No, he needs to make a beeline down there. He's going to help with pushing, as he said. Evelynn is actually better than Kha'Zix in the straight-up push game because she can get her attack speed buff or just off a minion and take down the turret quicker. Also, with the turret on bottom, not having that extra defense will help out.
Yeah.
So Yuzuki just heading over level 1. Since he is uncoordinated, they won't be able to get that 4-man level 2. And it's going to be spread out a little bit more unevenly.
LMQ slightly flubbed this push right here. They actually lost most of their first wave in this one with the cannon menu wave. Vasili also took some damage, but here comes the initial push. This turret will be going down. I want to see if the cannon minion actually dies, though. It's taken a bit of punishment. C9T definitely will lose their cannon, I believe.
They have more range minions, though. Gonna help out.
Okay, so turret is down. Looks like the similar situation there. Cannon did die. LMQ slightly smaller wave, but otherwise pretty equal in footing. And Lee Sin's actually a great turret pusher. He has attack speed on the kit as well. Bishu landing a bit of damage to Xiao Wei Xiao. Actually, nice dodge on the chains. But Bishu down 8 CS with this one. See how it goes.
While we're talking about tower pushing, Renekton, you can reset your auto attack with this stun. Though you can't obviously stun the turret. People often still use it just to reset. Yeah. An extra auto in there. Two turrets down. Everybody full steam ahead. The game of chicken continues. Will we see inhibitors go down? C9T are behind. Pretty late recalls here. They might actually get it.
Down below half HP, we'll see if C9T can stop this push because LMQ are not slowing down. They're low on minions.
Oh,
they might stick. The lead showing up.
Yazki
there.
It.
They do take that one down. The slow comes out, though. Is that enough to turn this fight around? Moore has a stun. Lands a bit on Yazki, but he's going in anyway. Moore very, very low. The re-engage. Ignite pop. Summoner heals, but here comes Kez. Looks now for Vasili, who's only at half HP. Kez forced to back up.
Really, they're looking to stall the recalls here and allow Altec to get more farm during there at the turret, but LMQ are able to get away long enough for the teleport down bottom. And tower advantage over to LMQ. Inhibitor already exposed. Who's going to make a move for this dragon? It doesn't look like either team is going to be rushing it since they both recall safely to base. It's very hard to tank that one up when your opponents have the same numbers as you. Yuzuki this time around on Renekton. We'll be stuck up top though, teleport.
Yeah, so the thing to keep in mind with this matchup as well with the turrets going down is that an inhibitor turret's worth 175 gold to each person on the map, which gives Xiao Wei Xiao 175 gold lead in his mid lane matchup there over Bishu. He'll be half an item up, or half a basic item up at all times, which can matter. The 20 extra AP could mean an all-in. It could mean a Fiendish Codex being completed and better cooldowns.
Yeah. He'd have to go back to base first, though.
True.
And he's got really heavy consumable starts. So he could easily stay out here much, much longer. Now, as we said, it would be a one champion advantage for LMQ at this dragon. However, it does a large portion of your health and damage this early in the game. It would be feasible for Cloud9 to at least poke them at the dragon, but they decide to just give it up.
Yeah.
Don't want to risk it.
Well played, LMQ.
Yeah, they'll allow Renekton to try and shove that top lane. Now, for the dragon, they weren't able to do anything with their bottom lane. That was a two-minion wave that was stacking up. Altec was able to prune that one down to size.
Yazuki does get the top lane pushed in, so that'll be a lot of minions suiciding under the turret. That's kind of the only answer C9T got for it.
Yeah, he'll get a few. Down bottom, though, Kez.
He's going to look good for this. Moore getting the stuns up. Kez low on health. Summoner heal burned, actually. The re-engage, though, 3 versus 2. Moore getting away with the summoner heal. Vasili around as well. But there comes the Kha'Zix on the re-engage. C9T forced away, losing summoners in the process.
All right, so LMQ hold on to their advantage. All said and done for the early game. It was their call, and they came out ahead this time around. So, pretty good move there from LMQ. And the teleport really helped them as well, allowing Ackerman to go defend bottom quicker than usual.
Yeah, and he was able to get to the top lane quicker than usual as well. He started on the correct side of the map. Yazuki didn't really guess properly, was at the top, had to walk all the way across, and was late to the party. So all those things kind of coming into effect right here. LMQ to a 1,500 gold lead. 1,600 gold lead, actually, very early on in this game, with that being a turret and a dragon for this one. So now Cloud9 Tempest playing from the disadvantage. LMQ, we talked about them being all about picking people off. And with the gold lead, they might just do that.
And the item discrepancy that you were looking for in the mid lane has manifested itself in the form of a Fiendish Codex. in the favor of Xiaowei Shao. Quite strong this early. Blue buffs will be traded off. Doesn't look like there will be any sort of invade from Cloud9 Tempest to try and deny that one from Xiaowei Shao.
But he is going to make his way towards this red buff here. Yazuki not really in a good place to stop this.
Ackerman shoving in. Is level 6 to Yuzuki's 5. That's why we're going to make that move. One of the rare roams from Xiaowei Shao. And he doesn't get anything out of it yet.
Well, they've still got control, though. Ward's coming across. Here comes the engage from Ackerman. He has pulled it into the brush.
Eve has smite, and there's a ward inside. So very low chance of this red buff going over to LMQ. And then, until no name comes, and he's got the execute.
Pulling not close enough. Smite. He's level 6 on this one. Pops a bit of damage across.
He got his ulti leveled up. They didn't want to find it anyway.
Didn't go.
So, LMQ, they should have kept that red buff a little bit higher health and waited for No Name to join. He was a few steps away of coming. And then Kha'Zix would easily have the advantage, could combo with his Q.
Yeah, well, doesn't quite happen. But the bottom lane, though, I feel like this one's going well for LMQ. You're seeing Annie put out the damage. Xiaowei Shao grabs his blue buff there. Kez going to make the roam, though, not through a ward. Has the ultimate.
Try number 2 here. He's going to attack the bottom lane. They still have one flash on
no
him.
No flash for more, though. They're going to go in. Here's the teleport. They turn it around. That's going to be enough. The 5-minute cooldown. All tech forced away.
Canceled, so it's not.
3-minute cooldown.
Yeah.
All right.
But worth it. You don't only have to use the ulti there. Couple ultis, actually. Altec used his culling as well. Good awareness by Cloud9, not over-committing to that.
Smart choice. I wonder, would it have been possible to do enough damage to like get rid of Annie and then just like re-engage the 3v2? I think without cooldowns, it'd be hard, though.
He would have to have a little bit better positioning as well coming in for the gank.
Okay.
Hard for him to get out. Annie is extremely hard to gank as Evelynn.
Wow. Some good early damage. Bishu is taking hits with this one. Of course, with the flask for Xiaowei Shao, he can kind of take these trades and just get his health back. Bishu's just kind of hemorrhaging a little bit of HP. Does get some poke back down. Of course, being down the Fiendish Codex means less shields, less damage. Just wave clearing back and forth, though. 89 to 70. Again and again, Xiaowei Shao doing a great job with minions. There's a pink ward on the right side of mid put down by No Name. Again, the attempted push in lands the root, actually. This is not great for Bishu. Still taking damage this matchup.
Yeah, you know, he's down in CS, but that's to be expected against Xiaowei Shao, as usual. I don't think there was a lot of mid lane intervention either. Pretty much all of the side pushing.
Chain dodge, though. Bishu gonna get jumped on, low on health, bursted down. Silence being enough. First blood goes to Xiaowei Shao. LMQ looking so far great in this game 5.
Ackerman as well. Able to get out easily. He's got 3 people to deal with, though. Should probably be just a force down turret for Cloud9. Gleeb walks right into Ackerman, and they
push them out. They
pass.
Will get the turret trade. Mid lane is under fire.
Passing in the night.
Yeah, pretty much. This time they saw them, though. Yeah, mid lane turret going to be going down. Just the stealth Evelynn waiting around Ackerman to join this one.
2 turrets for 1, though. Are they getting bottom as well?
Oh, yeah. You're right. LMQ with a big rotational advantage. They're very far ahead now. 5 turrets to 3. Remember, one of those turrets is actually an inhibitor turret in the top lane. I mean, there's a wealth of gold still available just at the tier 2s. C9T still looking, though, for tier 2 top lane. The rotation coming from No Name and Ackerman, though, looks like Xiaowei Shao is taking some damage. But C9T not really committing. Yazuki actually pulled back to fight for this one. More's coming soon.
They look for the kick under the turret. Little bit early.
Engage for the damage, but the re-engage. Tibbers putting out huge pain. LMQ diving in for this one. The culling coming across. Gonna kill off Tibbers. Poor Annie missing her best friend. Very low health on the Glebe Glarb, but No Name does not want to keep going in. Yazuki pulling a bit of tension. Now all 5 of C9T topside.
Yeah, they swing over. Evelynn coming with Lulu. But it's a little bit late, and LMQ do not decide to continue. Good choice by them. They're able to chase off Cloud9 and retain their advantage. That's all that they wanted to do, was retain that tower advantage. Great global goal that they were able to get from that last move. 2-for-1 turrets, and they didn't have to lose much. It was just a little bit of health on the top.
Big damage towards Kez, but just jumps over the wall, honestly. Not much required from Xiaowei Shao to make that happen. But the pink ward will go down. That one did not live long. That was No Name's just a few minutes ago.
I think that burst that he took for that pink ward, though, might be the difference in this dragon fight. Evelyn's trying to chug his potion right now. They do at least call in the teleport. There's no teleport for Cloud9.
Yeah, so 5v4, even with Xiaowei Xiao low, this could be the good fight. Burst going across, half HP on Dragon. Will Kez engage with this one? Looks like Cloud9 Tempest are scared of this one. Burst comes through, blue team picks up Dragon.
They're respecting that Tibbers, even though Tibbers is not back up yet. Nobody wanted to get close to Annie. Moore was able to zone.
CNNT playing a bit more afraid game three right now. They're down in gold and afraid to take fights, which does mean they're giving away objectives, though. And right now, CNNT not finding many things to do in this game. Their objective trades have been negative. They've taken 1 for 2 time and again.
Right from the beginning, with a swap from LMQ, Hizuki did not expect it and had to walk all the way down the map. They're looking to answer mid, though.
Big dive from Yazuki. Nice knock up 3-man from Lulu. They're going in towards more. More will go down. That's one mid lane turret under fire. C9T on the scoreboard of this one. No name waiting around on the side. Vasili waiting off of the wings as well. Glitterlance comes across. Looks like LMQ buy time for now, but next wave, this could be a turret kill.
Yeah, you were talking about LMQ are the ones doing most of the tower dives. Great job there by Cloud9. Getting in and out quick enough. Taking down the Annie before Tibbers was able to be used. Still down, and now they want to finish the turret!
Well, they get the stun on Ackerman, though. Big damage coming across. Force to disengage. Turret will fall. AoE Karma Shield. Keep the team in a good spot.
Bottom wave here. Bottom wave. They do not want to give up pressure. There's a giant glob of minions here for Cloud9. Because of it, they'll be awarded from blue buff here. Mm-hmm. Can they actually make a flank? If they circled back around towards mid, they would even be able to capitalize one more time. But they're going to take their blue buff and return back with just that.
That's a lot of gold and XP on Vasili, who's already got a Bloodthirster, and it's basically fully stacked by now.
Yep.
Altec gets his own BT, but looks like not more on top of that. So a big lead here. 20 minions plus the global gold. Vasili is much bigger than Altec when he goes back to shop.
So there's actually a similar size wave up top for Cloud9 to feed on, and they're giving it over to Renekton, who is split decision here. Decided to start with pickaxe and now moving more towards tank. Not going to complete that Tiamat quite yet. Well, let's see if he actually goes for that or completes Sunfire Cape first. Both of them actually help with pushing waves. Mm-hmm. But the Sunfire, a lot more tanky early.
It's true. You spend a lot of money for a bit more stats. You get like 70 health and 5 armor for like 900 gold. It's pretty much you're investing in the flames.
Trust in the flames.
Always got to.
For the night is dark and full of terrors.
I do not know what that's from.
Game of Thrones.
All right, well, there you go.
I don't know if that's deeper in the books than the series has caught up to, though.
Spoiler alert, I just know the quotes now.
Wow. I think they've already used it. They probably have.
Gonna be all right with this one. Cloud9 Tempest, though. Farming all the way back by their inhibitor. There was no turrets up there for Yazuki to fall back
but
to.
Look at the... look at the ward coverage, though. I mean, man, it's all LMQ invading on Cloud9's jungle. Since the very opening of the game, they were the ones making the first moves, as I said, and it was all down to execution for this team. They've got so much damage. If they're able to execute, if they're able to make the first step, get the initiative, then it's up to them to finish.
Yep.
Okay, Ackerman's pretty deep here.
He's going to get rooted up, but Kez is right there. Ackerman's got nowhere to go. Gets found.
All
right,
he made the first move, did not execute properly. And LMQ
offsides.
Just offsides there from Ackerman. And he's going to have to spend 15 more seconds in the penalty box, allowing a power play for Cloud9 Tempest.
We are multiple sports metaphors
it
there.
It was good.
I like
it. Just pile them on.
Home run for C9T.
Just pile them on.
What's it when you get a score in cricket? If Quickshot were here, he'd know.
Oh, God. Is that...
it's kind of like baseball. Did I just offend all the European viewers now, or is it too late for them to be watching anymore?
I don't even think it's all the European viewers. Like, isn't cricket mainly English?
I don't know.
I think it's actually... yeah. All right, well, Kez is doing some mobile ward work here. Side bonus of Evelyn. Able to see where everyone has committed to for LMQ. Moore does have his flash and Tippers available, so that comboed with the Graves really, really scary. Talking about the damage that they're packing, they can turn this team fight in the blink of an eye if he gets a good flash Tibbers.
And this turret's super low. Yasuke could just tank the damage for it. He will, but this is a bit dangerous.
Taking big pain back.
He might get himself killed by Ackerman. He's going to have a big heal. He could have a dash going away.
He used up a lot of the fury.
The Q hits. The flash. He actually follows through anyway.
Beautiful from Ackerman right there.
Too early on the flash. He could have won that fight.
Yeah.
But perfect play by Ackerman. Gets himself the kill back. Does get a turret kill, but heavy engage by Yasuke to get that one.
All right, Freak. In cricket, it's a run just like baseball. So
it's a run.
Not adding anything on.
All right, cool. Darn.
All right, let's get a replay of that. He really wants this turret. Kicks him off the turret. You have to slice back in. And here's where the loss of fury comes in. Off the dice.
Yep.
That was unfortunate for him. But because he goes for the flash and doesn't get an auto attack turnaround, the ignite, not going to take him down either. We already knew the outcome of that duel.
Yep.
Ackerman gets some vengeance.
So 2,000 gold game. More Vasili, Xiaowei, Xiao all here ready for Dragon. C19 not ready for this one, so looks like this will be another objective going over LMQ's way. Fed and Hip is making their way down, but they're not going to be there in time.
And I have to say, LMQ using that teleport pretty well since the beginning of the game. C9 definitely missing out on that summoner spell. This time around, Yuzuki hasn't been able to do that much with his ignite instead.
And you know, speaking of the teleport, Distortion already picked up for Ackerman. Mm-hmm. He's got a extremely low cooldown.
Hey, doesn't it give you some new move speed after flash now too?
You get about 2 seconds of 30% move speed after TP, or 1 second after a flash.
That's for even easier Dragon Rage kicks back into your team.
Yeah.
You can position yourself that much quicker.
Vasili on the flank gets spotted out by Kez, though. Has to flash the wall.
Offsides. But he gets away with it.
Yeah.
Just a yellow card.
You definitely don't get yellow cards for offsides. He does not like that wall.
Yuzuki has tried to go through that wall from both sides. And has failed both times.
It's very unfortunate.
Just keeps ramming his head against it. Putting a dent in that wall. Pretty soon that wall is going to give way.
He is doing some deforestation. Trying to get rid of the trees. Hates nature, Yasuke.
Man, this game, because it's the game five, I feel like...
There it is! Oh, the flash by Bishu keeps him safe, though. Ackerman has to get away. He does, though, with the ward hop. Clutch right there.
Tibbers down.
Bomb on. Tibbers does die. Smite secures
gold.
It. Kez rich now. Quick wave clear for LMQ. The 1-0-0 LeBlanc. He doesn't pick it to, like, rest his control over the map. He's just like, I'm going to farm, and I'll kill you in team fights later. Aldite gets the red buff. Already has a blue for himself. 2-2 in the game, 2,500 gold. LMQ going in for this one early.
There's no way for Cloud9 to get vision of this without going through more.
They're not checking.
Oh yeah, this is great move from LMQ. I like the no hesitation. They just scared off Cloud9, plus they know they have complete control with the double pink wards this early in the game.
Yep. C9T find out too late. They'll know the timer by seeing those purple flowers floating around, but that's a big boost of golden XP. LMQ now up 4,000 and a Baron buff.
Two outer turrets left up for them to try and knock down as well. But really, it's not that great of a siege team here from LMQ. They need to make use of their split push, make use of their great ward cover to try and pick somebody. It's hard for them to actually do anything around the turrets. The only thing that they would try and go for really would be to stun somebody with Annie who's a bit away from the turret and go with their range burst. They have great range burst as well. They don't have to all-in commit to somebody. If they get up around a turret and somebody from Cloud9 steps up too far, they can stun them and execute them with the Graves and LeBlanc combo.
Guess they'll be sending them to their graves.
Ba-dunk.
Yeah. Ackerman. Gonna make his way up. Killing off the minions does have no summoners, but really a whole lot of wave clear. 150 minions. Still basically treading water against Yasuke, but the mid lane matchup and the AD carry matchup, you've got pretty substantial leads right here. So LMQ, their key players are very far ahead. Death cap already done. Yasuke pushed around a little bit, but you're seeing an item lead in the mid lane and a pretty substantial item lead for AD carry. Static Shiv ordered done for Vasili, so even more burst is there. That's going to mean a lot, because until Altec gets Triforce, he's going to be behind.
It also means super, super fast wave clear for Graves. He already has Buckshot. Adding Static Shiv onto that is amazing for the wave clear.
And keep in mind, top lane has no turret, so C9T must respond to this wave right here, because Vasili is about to be threatening an inhibitor.
Oh, they are right. They don't even have to siege up at a turret. They can try and force a fight around the exposed inhibitor. They will do so. This is going to be the four-man squad as well. No tanks in this fight. I have to give that advantage over to Moore, because he's got the stun ready to go. This is going to be 5-on-4, dead inhibitor.
Ethan Ackerman definitely going to be the inhibitor
dead
down.
Inhibitor.
We'll respawn before Baron comes up by about 35 seconds. It's fairly relevant here, but ultimately it means LMQ are going to have map control for quite a bit longer.
Kez
wants to go in. The knock up to Ackerman. Big burst comes out from Xiao Wei Xiao. Doesn't quite get any kills, though. Dual Glitterlands comes across, putting some damage still there.
Now, LMQ were spread out, so it was an attack from the side, but you know, not really any follow-up there. And pretty big ulti down for Cloud9. Once again, that teleport for LMQ doing so much more than the ignite on Renekton. Get the inhibitor, and now the mid-turret siege.
They're going to try a Baron buff. Will time out within the next minute here, but that's going to be a couple of waves. They still get the chance for the flash forced away. Xiao Wei Xiao does get removed in the 1v2, but he's going to join his team reaching up with Baron. They've got another wave coming.
All right, Lulu is strong wave clear. Lucian is decent as well. But there's just so much danger from this Annie. Everybody on Cloud9 has to watch their positioning. They cannot afford to group up. Lucian next to either Lulu or Evelynn would be devastating.
So LMQ snowball to a 5,000 gold lead. They kill away the jungle as they go. Smart choices there. Remove as much gold as possible and gain golden XP for your team. You see minions dropping away rather quickly, but C9T still. They've got to be afraid of this one.
By the way, the reason I say that is because Evelynn is still pure assassin at this point. Hasn't transitioned into the tanky phase where she starts building Randuin's and things like that. Still 100% assassin, all damage. Alatek able to dash away.
But you can see the wave clear there. So easy for Vasili to remove the minions. They push in once more. The Culling coming across, but now blocked by No Name, keeping his wave alive. Unless C9T go in right here, they're going to lose that one. They get away with enough, killing the minions off. LMQ backs off.
Yeah, they're making great use of this zoning threat from Annie right now, even allowing Graves with a short range to get in on the turret.
Yeah.
They gotta watch out, though. Evelynn's ulti is back up. He's looking for the side.
Four wants it. Finds a three-man ulti. There comes the dive from Renekton. Xiao Wei Xiao pops the clone. He does go down. 1-0. Top lane Dex's turret going down, though, as we speak. Can they find any more? Top turret number one goes down. More's gonna fall. 2-0 in exchange for the turret. And now the second one's going down. Someone's gotta go back and defend that right now. Looks like that's going to be Altec on Lucian. The new minion wave spawn's gonna keep that safe. Now Dragon is up. C9T can get something back.
Yes, that will be an objective here. Unless No Name can come up with a steal. Four members of Cloud9 are still at the Dragon. Yeah, No Name not even going to go for that steal. So, great objective there for Cloud9. They're able to get the fight on the bottom side now.
Wow.
Even though they are down another Nexus turret.
Altec couldn't hold the wave, so the Nexus is now completely open. Baron's up in a minute and 45 seconds. The Inhib's respawning soon.
That last fight does show why I put so much emphasis on initiative in this game, though. Because Cloud9 are the ones with the tank, and they're the ones getting the initiative in the team fights. It goes fully against LMQ. They're so squishy. Everyone is squishy. Once their battle line is breached, everyone has to scramble. And they can't hold together. They can't focus their fire on the stunned target from Annie. Everybody just has to run away.
So now at this point, C9T are permanently one team fight away from the game being out of their reach. Inhibitor plus Nexus, not that hard to kill with Death Timers. Now 27 minutes into the game. C9T have to play pretty much perfectly from here on out. Baron 1 minute away. Inhibitor's going to be going away. Ackerman gets the tier 2 turret in the bottom lane, meaning the only turrets left on the map for C9T defend the bottom and middle inhibitors. Yasuki in a bit of a trade. LMQ getting position over the Baron pit. Kez going to try to grab red buff for the team. No steal comes in, but an early smite for Kez. Inhibitor's back. That means the last super minion wave has just been cleared away. There's only regular minions left. Baron in 40 seconds. The map could be equalized, but one catch could mean the game for LMQ.
Ooh, Morgan going to run straight into Kez.
10 gold.
No stun used. even though he did have no name to back him up, they don't have that deep vision that they were relying on before. And since everyone is fairly squishy, can't overextend. Even though they do have the gold lead again, it's all about the first step in that team fight. If they can start it off with more landing the AoE stun, it'll be a massacre.
Uh-oh. LMQ waiting in the brush to go for the engage.
Correct.
Flash! Oh, he misses! Does not take him down. Gleeb stays alive. LMQ get rid of some wards, but...
Yeah, Cloud9.
Here's the teleport. LMQ going to start Baron.
Easy for a little bit longer. They don't have to worry about the Tibbers this time, but it will be a miracle steal. This is against the Lee Sin.
Kez in a dangerous spot. Going to get jumped on.
Oh.
Big damage comes through. Takes the KOs, but getting exploded. There's a kill for LMQ. No smite for Cloud9 Tempest.
On the top side? Not able to answer with anything. Xiao Xiao double dashes away.
Gleeb gonna get jumped on as well by the Kha'Zix. Puts the slowdown, puts the root as well. But more, and Xiao Wei. Xiao gonna land the root, gonna land the damage. Another kill picked up.
Yeah, you've got Karma Tether. Xiao Xiao has the LeBlanc chains. Much stronger. Those at the real chains. They do not break. All right, 3 versus 5. Desperate attempt to stop the Baron here.
Some poke on a Xiao Wei Xiao. Decent damage. Actually, Yasuke gonna go in, doesn't quite land the stun. Chain's not gonna hit either, though. 5 versus 3. C9T forced to disengage.
Yeah, nobody wants to tank that thing. So, LMQ, yes, they pick off 2 more kills. They bolster their lead. However, not able to claim the end of the Baron. So, they're gonna need to retain some vision here. Cloud9 need to take this little bit of breathing room, try and secure some vision.
Uh-oh.
Izuki.
Speaking of vision, Xiao Wei Xiao's gonna land the chain. Yasuke pops the ult. He has some fury, but he's down well below half HP. He's gonna get bursted out. Ackerman claims the kill. Now 5-4 LMQ. C9T though on the rotation. Can they find it? The slow. The damage coming across. Can they get the kill? Culling used. Xiao Wei Xiao will drop. Now they look for Ackerman. He's gonna try to get over the wall. The ward spot the retreat. He's gonna flash. Glitter Lance not going to land here as well, though. More damage coming across. No Name is there for the safeguard.
Graves going up the mid, though.
Still on the chase. Yes, Vasili is pushing. No Name still running away. More is there for the defense. Looks like LMQ might get the mid lane inhibitor turret right now. Will there be enough recalls to keep this alive? This turret's going down.
Rest of the team is just trying to stop those recalls. Actually, Kha'Zix jumps in to stop one.
They're going to kill away some wards. LMQ controlling this map very nicely. The split push AD carry. He can make his way down to bot if he wants for a big wave. But he says, no, I'm going to contest Baron one more time. Ward control still here for LMQ. But the ward comes down for C9T, keeps it safe.
2 exposed inhibitors and an exposed Nexus here. Cloud9 are walking on eggshells. As he said, 1 lost team fight will be the end of the game for them. They cannot afford a misstep.
C9T have a total of 1 turret left. They have 2 exposed inhibitors and a bot lane inhibitor turret. Any of those go down, should not be hard for LMQ to close the game out. Right now we sit on a 6,000, 6,500 gold lead. LMQ is actually slowly stretching that lead, trading kills back and forth, but just finding more globals, finding more jungle to kill. Ackerman gonna get a big wave for himself, the distortion.
And he used that money for the last whisper. He's not going more tanky, he's more damage here.
It's a risky build, but if it pays off, it can one-shot somebody. It's a big deal. Kaz gonna get blue buff over to Bishu, who's only level 13, actually. The levels, I gotta say, are a pretty big deal. Graves and LeBlanc, both 15 here. The Lee Sin, 16. Yasuke only 15, Kaz only 14, Bishu only 13.
At least they have the advantage in Smite. Kaz 14 to 13 Kha'Zix. However, Kha'Zix can combo that damage much easier. Teleport. Not up yet, so Lee Sin just going to be up there trying to draw attention away for another 25 seconds.
And for a short time, C9T has actually equalized the AD carry damage output. Until rank 3 Graves ulti, the ADs are basically the same spot. Yes, there's a BF sword here for Vasili, but 3 completed items is the big tier to watch for. So both these guys contribute a lot of threat in a battle. Both teams have Mikhails. We're going to have Twin Shadows coming out soon for Gleeb. That might actually help the team get some picks. We see an equal ability to team fight with 5 kills per side. It's just the objectives putting LMQ ahead. 5 turrets, a bunch of dragons.
Yeah, basically, LMQ, they could toss this game if they get Evelynn ulted inside the Baron pit.
Moore's going to have to flash over the wall. He's going to give red control over to C9T.
It's a pretty big win for them. Moore's also at half life. That bought them some more time.
Well, here's a battle, though. Ackerman 16 to Yazgi's 15 has to disengage. Renekton not able to win this fight. And, of course, remember, there is still the teleport lead for Lee Sin. At any time, there could be a 5v4 for LMQ. They're going to try that at Baron. Ward over the wall. It's going to be the team trying to come down to stop this one. No Name down to half.
All right.
Missing some HP for this one.
What they're really looking for is a four-man Evelynn ulti. Can he get in position, though? He would have to flash for it.
Chain won't land. Here comes the jump on in. Kez going to land the ulti. Tabor's going to get dodged away from Moore. A bit low on health. Here comes the re-engage. Chain lands on the Glebe. He's going to get out. Kez forced back as well.
Ackerman!
One hit, dead. Mikhail's. Randoms keeps him alive. Altec on the chase, but the safeguard. It's not going to happen. There's the
dead
flash. Altec still not in range, but there's Yazgi on the other side. Knock backwards, kill finally goes through to Altec. 1-0, but there's no help on C9T.
The one thing that could turn this around was the Evelynn ult at Baron. And LMQ go to Baron. They get Eve ulted. They chase him down. Altec barely able to come out with the kill on Ackerman. And it's only a one-man kill, so it's not that much gold in itself. But it leads to the dragon. Comeback dragon's huge in the game now. That is a substantial amount of bonus experience awarded, as well as the global gold.
That's a lot of XP for Glebe and Vishi right here.
Huge.
Altec should back up.
All right, so Eve on. Oh, it only actually hit two because he didn't flash for it. But two was enough because they got more low enough that he had to panic Tibbers here. Does he panic Tibbers? No. He actually just runs us straight out of it. Just kidding. Tibbers was probably used earlier.
It died in that fight.
Oh, okay. So the Tibbers, it didn't hit anybody at the beginning. Anyways, how did
he turn?
He turned the corner.
Instead of walking straight down. Although with Triforce move speed, I think he would still outrun Lee Sin. The 8% buff you get from it is pretty substantial.
Yeah. But still.
Yeah. Still, it's super close. 1-0. Down to 5,000 gold. That's been bridged slightly. Xiaowei on top of a ward. Jumps back over. Puts a ward down. Bottom lane actually pushing down toward LMQ's base. 34 and a half minutes. Moore's going to get his team some ward control over Baron Pit.
The question is, why did LMQ keep going back to Baron? Why don't they just go to one of these nice, safe inhibitors that have no turrets close to them?
I'm not sure, actually.
Tunneling on that Baron? It's a dangerous game.
Getting the stun pushed in. Lazki going to look for the jump in. And down goes Annie. 1-0.
The initiative! The first step is so important with this squishy, damage-heavy comp that LMQ are running, and they're just waiting around with Cloud9 have vision. They're inside the Baron Pit. Everybody there. It hasn't rained yet, so the magic damage debuff not there.
All right, how's the smite going to go? How's the damage going to go? Yazgi is towards the front lines. The entire C9T team
forced
towards the back. Kez going to stay alive. There's the engage. Over the wall goes the flashes. Bishu's going to be safe. Kill picked up. Two so far. LMQ. It's going to be C9T forced back.
Oh my god, they give away the Baron.
And Baron goes to LMQ with two kills as well.
Wow, everyone just tunneling on this Baron is ridiculous, but it's exciting, Freak.
It is. But there's gigantic waves now for LMQ to farm. This gold lead is going to go from 7k to 8 or 9 as these minions all go down.
It's all right. Well, Cloud9, they get a perfect pick. They take out the initiator. They take out Annie. The AoE stun. The core of the LMQ burst. And then they corner themselves in Baron.
Yeah. The damage came through the
attack
all angles
as
well.
The tragic story of Cloud9 Tempest.
Yep. Baron got the greater of them. So did LMQ so far.
Oh, juicy wave. Who gets it? Is Ackerman going to be
He's actually waiting
a bro?
For his friend.
He is. He's giving it to
I think it'll
Vasily.
Give Vasily eye edge. That's probably the reason.
A lot of money fed over to Vasily. He's going to be a beast next team fight.
Vishi with the blue buff. You're going to see 1,400 gold. It's like 2,250 to go from BF sword to eye edge. So he's got some time to go. Well, he's got the pickaxe. So yeah, that's enough. It's like 1,375 there. So. There's the combined four offensive items. Vasily is Graves, and he has a Mikhail's on his team. Is reasonably well protected. We've seen actually a lot of safeguards, defensive safeguards, from Ackerman to keep the team alive, so that might work well.
I mean, his upfront burst is ridiculous. A static shiv procced Infinity Edge crit.
Mm-hmm.
A buckshot, also collateral damage. Even smokescreen does a lot of damage right now.
Yeah. That 40 AP from Baron buff.
Yeah, man.
Adding the damage.
People always forget about the hybrid nature of Baron.
Helps right. Everybody a little
bit. So now that they have the Baron buff,
yeah,
our long war that was waged over the Baron, has been won.
Ackerman,
and it should
though,
be a clear path.
Gets you, little ants.
You go to an exposed inhibitor.
Safe though. Oh, the engage towards Bishu. Evil comes across. The Vasili forced back. Great Timbers. Kez going to go down. 1-0. The Baron buff still on LMQ. They hop back forward. Bishu forced to disengage. Vasili is still wreaking havoc. Yazuki gonna be going down. 2-3 kills picked up in the fight. LMQ find a fourth. This is gonna be the game. It goes to all five, but LMQ gonna close out and take the Challenger Series Championship.
What a finish. Cloud9 get the pick that they wanted, yet they start the Baron. They get cornered inside, and LMQ run them out of it, take the Baron, and finish the game running up.